All right. Hey, welcome everybody. Thanks for tuning in to Catamount Connections. I'm Chris Cooper. I'm a Robert Lee Madison Distinguished Professor of Political Science and Public Affairs, and I'm Department Head of Political Science and Public Affairs at Western Carolina University. And as I do sometimes, I'm here to talk about politics, but really politics related to COVID-19. And fortunately for me and for you guys watching, the person who's here to share it with us is a guy named Lance. And Lance is one of our fine MPA students at Western. So small pitch for our MPA. We are still accepting applications for the fall. And it's a great program. We can talk more about that another day. But Lance is really tuned in to lots of things political. He's really got a great nose for state politics and for local politics. And whether he wants to or not, he is spending some time this semester in my class learning more about state and local responses to COVID-19. He went to undergraduate at one of our sister schools, University of North Carolina at Asheville, and we're pleased to have him in our program and here. So I'll pass off to Lance real quick.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Cooper, and thanks for having me on today. As Dr. Cooper was saying, I'm in his state and local governments class this semester in the MPA program. So touching on a lot of things, North Carolina politics in particular, even down to the county level too. So with the pandemic, you know, it's not a great time, but as far as covering pandemic related issues, it's a good class to be in at this time. So lots of good stuff.
I'll just say, and I'll pass to Lance for kind of questions or to get this thing going in a second. I'll say in the front end, clearly, I'm not an epidemiologist or a public health expert, and I don't think Lance is either. So when it comes to the specifics of, you know, how somebody should act or the best ways to combat this, I think we're both doing what we hope everybody's doing, which is following the government advice, wearing a mask when we're out in public, social distancing, all the things that we're told to do, staying at home. So we're not going to weigh in too much on those issues, but we are going to talk about the politics of this and how folks are reacting and what this can teach us about politics more generally. So with that, I'll pass to Lance.
Yeah. So in the class this semester, we've actually been assigned since all of this broke out, short comparison papers comparing North Carolina and another state. The state that I'm comparing to in their local government, state government response is Colorado. And just kind of seeing like the variance across different states, since mainly a lot of the combating this issue has all been mainly at the state level. A lot of it has like stay at home orders are all issued by governors. So comparing like how Governor Cooper in North Carolina and Governor Polis in Colorado responded, relatively pretty similar responses by and large. North Carolina, Governor Cooper actually signed some orders postponing like evictions and things like that for people unable to pay rent and stuff, you know, doing massive job losses during this. Colorado has actually not done that, but they both have stay-at-home orders, restaurants, bars closed except for takeout, that kind of thing. So that's been interesting to kind of see the similarities and the differences between those two states for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's, you know, so most states, as I think people know, have given these orders. The states that haven't, I believe, Arkansas, Iowa, Nebraska, South Dakota, North Dakota, South Carolina until very recently, and then Wyoming and Utah, I believe. So a lot of people have looked at this, kind of what makes states act and what makes states not act. And clearly there is maybe a partisan dimension to this if you look at the, you know, partisanship of some of these governors. At the same time, though, I think it's worth noting these are primarily rural states, right? States that are even more rural than North Carolina. So Nebraska and South Dakota and North Dakota and Wyoming and places like this. So yes, partisanship is part of this, but I think sometimes we've been overplaying the partisanship angle. And I think rural has been just as important. And I'll add, in North Carolina, you know, I just spent some time looking at the counties. We've got 100 counties in North Carolina. And I was like, well, I wonder what the partisanship of the counties that kind of entered in earlier or later into this. And frankly, I expected to see maybe there'd be a partisan angle. And what I found was that wasn't really true, that Republican county commissions acted about as early on average as Democratic county commissions. So the administrative local government response has not been hyper-partisan. So I think that is maybe a small silver lining to this dark cloud we're all living in.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, it's interesting. I was looking at, I believe it was a New York Times map of, you know, people's movement since a lot of this has all started. And a lot of the movement they were talking about were like in those states, in like Wyoming and Nebraska and the Dakotas, or rural parts of most states. And, you know, I think one thing that was maybe missing of that analysis, though, was, you know, if you live in a very rural area, you're having to travel greater distances even to get to a grocery store. You know, I'm from a small northwestern North Carolina town, and it's like a dozen miles to the nearest Ingles. I mean, having to travel that far just to get basic groceries instead of just going 2 miles or walking to a grocery store, it's just, it's not as comparable as if you were like in the city of Charlotte or something like that.
No, I think that's right. I think this pandemic is hitting urban and rural areas in very different ways. And I've been a little, like you, suspect of some of these data we've been seeing the national media put out. There was one that got a lot of attention. I think somebody tweeted out from the New York Times said, the problem is, in two words, the South. And the idea was that the South wasn't really responding and other places were. And I think that is a really gross oversimplification. One, the rural nature, some of these places, like you pointed out. And then obviously this thing hits blue collar folks differently than it hits white collar folks. It's one thing to stay work at home if you're a professor, if you are somebody in the knowledge economy. It's very different to say that if you are a UPS driver or if you are a wait staff, service industry, obviously Asheville has been hit particularly hard. So yeah, it hits everybody the same way from a health perspective, but it hits us all very differently socially and politically.
For sure. And, you know, speaking off of, you know, just differing local government responses, for my internship class this semester, I've actually been an intern for Graham County government, which is one of the most furthest west counties in the state. I mean, it's an hour beyond Coley. And it's very rural, one of the most sparsely populated counties in the state. You know, has a pretty conservative political bent to it, but their county government acted very early, realizing that the health infrastructure is just not there. They don't even have a hospital in the county. I think they have pretty much what's a step above like an urgent care, but less than a hospital. And the nearest hospital would be the tribal hospital in Cherokee, but like the nearest public accessible hospital is Harris and Silva, which is an hour away. So you have to think, if that county had an outbreak and you're an hour from the nearest hospital, it's just gonna be that much harder to get people the care they need. So they took some pretty drastic measures, having sheriff's department doing pretty much roadblock checks at the county line. If you're not from Graham County, you're not allowed in the county. They've got a lot of outdoor recreation there, so a lot of people would come camp there, something like that. You can imagine somebody from an urban center like Charlotte or Atlanta coming up there to escape COVID, going to a campground, could potentially bring it into the county, and then there's an outbreak. So they responded pretty aggressively beyond, you know, what the state has mandated for sure.
Yeah, and I think that's a great example, too, of the kinds of decisions that are being made across the state. Small kind of Homer pitch. Of course, the county manager in Graham County is a WCU MPA grad, just a wonderful person. The somebody involved with their social service is also a WCU MPA grad. But I think it's been really interesting to watch some of these rural counties and how they've responded so professionally. Yeah. And these folks really just extraordinary public servants right now that are trying to balance some of the hardest questions anybody has.
Yeah, I know Dare County, I believe on the Outer Banks, is taking very similar measures. Same kind of thinking, rural, not a huge hospital access, a lot of out-of-town visitors that might be interested in leaving hot spots and could potentially bring it into those counties. They're just not set up for it.
That's exactly right, yeah. I mean, I think this sort of the whole, you know, everything we're dealing with, It illustrates a lot of these tensions that we just have in American politics and state local politics more generally, right? So it turns out at the beginning there was this pretty big partisan divide. A lot of that's gone away. Everybody kind of realizes this is real and this can – it's indiscriminate in who it hits. But these questions about the economy versus public safety, tensions about who should be in charge. I mean, you've got – some governors going on Meet the Press saying, hey, look, federal government, you need to be having a nationwide stay-at-home order. When's the last time we've seen that in American politics? State government saying, hey, federal government tell us what to do. So it's really, you know, local governments that are responding in some cases before state governments are. You mentioned Cherokee, and clearly the issues of federalism there. We've got
our own reservation
right here. Exactly. So I think it really illustrates, you know, a lot of these tensions we've been having. The voting rights issues. Very active debate right now over vote by mail and whether we should be increasing vote by mail or not. That is falling on partisan lines. It's revealing a lot about American politics and about fissures and sometimes places where we unify.
Yeah. And then even just all the focus, like nationally, being on the pandemic, and, you know, rightfully so. But as we were talking about before we went live, just like, you know, we're in the middle of a presidential election, and the Democrats just, you know, have now had their presumptive nominee, and it's kind of a blip in the news, so to speak. Just pretty much covered up by the national coverage.
It is. It's, you know, there's been a lot of articles written lately about how do you campaign in a pandemic. And, you know, I think in some ways the media is doing what they should be doing. I mean, I've been very impressed locally, you know, in Western North Carolina, whether it's Blue Ridge Public Radio or the Asheville Citizen Times or the Silva Herald, Smoky Mountain News, Mountain Express, these places and many more, Waynesville Mountaineer, I could go on, are all experiencing economic problems, but boy, are they doing some great reporting on COVID-19 and how it's affecting our communities. So I think this also highlights how much we need the media, how much we need folks being watchdogs at this critical moment in American history.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it is definitely going to be, I think, looking back historically, one of those in a different manner. I mean, how people look at 9/11 or Pearl Harbor, just like a moment in history in this country that and globally that I think most people will never forget. It'll be a marker for a long time in history, for sure.
That's right. And it looks like we just got a question in about Medicaid expansion and whether we could end up having Medicaid expansion come out of this. I'll say I don't, unless this election changes the balance of power in a significant way, which is possible, I doubt we're going to see a real change in Medicaid expansion in the short run. And I think it's important to remember some of these bigger dynamics that were happening before COVID, right? So we still do not have a state government budget, right? So our fiscal year ended June 30th, and we're essentially operating on last year's budget. Depending on who you are, you can blame either the governor's mansion, or you can blame the General Assembly. I won't go into that. There's plenty of blame to go around. And so we're all operating with these things that occurred before. Now, some folks are making an argument, hey, good thing we don't have a state budget because we have been able to hold on to some more money. Obviously, other people are saying, no, this would have been the time to expand Medicaid. So again, I think this reveals as many kind of existing fissures in American politics and in North Carolina.
For sure. And the partisan divide on that too. Like, I know Governor Cooper has been an advocate for expanding, you know, Medicaid and other social safety nets, while the General Assembly has been more hesitant. So seeing if there's a shift in the General Assembly's thinking long-term after this, you know, with being we're in a public health crisis, you know, it's yet to be seen, but it'd be interesting to follow. Kind of like with the stimulus at the national level. I mean, generally, if you're following, you know, kind of basic understanding of political ideologies, you know, spending government money, that kind of thing tends to be more of a, you know, on the liberal democratic side. But I mean, this was a bipartisan bill signed into law by a Republican president. So it's been interesting to watch that kind of shift in the middle of this too, where historically Republicans are more or less government, you know, pretty massive stimulus. I mean, it's the biggest in the country's history, is it not?
No, yeah, it's huge. And I think that is, it is interesting when I was watching even the response, since we have a question about voter turnout, which we'll get to in a second too. But so I was watching that, you know, both sides were complaining a lot about that stimulus package.
Yeah.
So I was kind of joking with some folks here, wait a second, you've got both parties that came together. The Democrats think it didn't go far enough. The Republicans think it went a little bit too far. That sounds like compelling policy to me, right? If you have both sides that had to give in a little, you know, really kind of see maybe that's the way government should work. It's ugly, but they got it done. And so is it perfect? No, but I think it was the result of some compromise that was important.
Yeah, for sure.
And so on the voter turnout, I think somebody asked a question about voter turnout, and let's just maybe contextualize a little bit. So we have kind of three, in my mind, and maybe Lance has some more to add, three stories to keep track of here. One, there's the primary in general, which of course we're focused on the presidential, but there's all sorts of things happening down ballot.
Oh, yeah.
Critical. In Western North Carolina, in the 11th congressional district, we have a second primary or a runoff, we tend to call it. The official name in North Carolina is second primary. And so that's on the Republican side only between Linda Bennett and Madison Cawthorn. So we've got, you know, we have that going on. And then we're also prepping, of course, for the general election that is already set in a lot of different ways. And so how is this going to affect the election is a great question. But it's a tough one to answer. So on the 11th, it seems like we've seen a little bit of a pause. I'm not saying Linda Bennett, Madison Cawthorn haven't been doing some things, but they haven't been quite as vocal as I would have expected. We've moved back the date from May 12th to June 23rd. So the state is responding. They're also trying to ramp up early voting. And so the last time we had a runoff in the 11th congressional district, about one in every four people who had voted in the previous primary voted in the runoff. Okay. So about 24%. So I would expect that we're going to see turnout that is lower than that. Would be my expectation given the logistical problems, given the bandwidth that people do not have left, given all that they're dealing with. So I would expect the runoff turnout to be very low. As far as other primaries, probably lower. As far as the general, it's awful far out for me to speculate on that one. Obviously, I don't know if we're going to have a second round of COVID issues, but the way in which the election is run may be different going forward. I don't know, Lance, if you have anything to add to that.
Yeah, no, man, I completely agree. I think, you know, in the primaries, both the second primary in NC11 and just some of the primaries that states have postponed, I mean, I think turnout will probably definitely be lower if I had to guess between, you know, as you said, people were tuned into other things. They're worrying about the virus. They're worrying about just getting food on their table. And then also, you know, even if things are starting to return to some sense of normalcy by the summer, I think a lasting effect of this is people will be nervous to being large groups of people for a while. So, you know, standing in line in a big city waiting to vote, you know, some of the pictures we saw of Wisconsin this past week, I think people are going to be hesitant to kind of put themselves in that environment in the near term, for sure.
Some of those counties, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, go ahead.
I was going to say some of those counties in Wisconsin even had 100%, twice as many people doing vote by mail as did.
Yes.
So the way, and we can get to that more in a second, but the way in which these elections is also shifting. But sorry.
Oh, no, you're good. But yeah, as far as the general election, it will be interesting just because we can't really know like how long this current outbreak is going to last. If there is going to be a fall reoccurrence, I just think it might be kind of almost a short election season. It might be, we kind of, things are all focused on the virus right now, and that may continue through the summer. And then we may not really start talking about the general election until September. So it might be a pretty short kind of general election where the last month or two we're really focused in on potentially the, you know, between Trump and presumably Biden. But yeah, it might be kind of a truncated election season.
It might. And it's interesting. That's what a lot of people have said they want, is kind of a shorter election season, less election noise. We'll see. I mean, again, I think part of this is going to depend on when the media shift, when, you know, all those media outlets talked about before, also forgot, certainly local TV as well, WLOS, folks like that, when they start focusing more again on the election. It looks like there's been a series of questions that came in. And so, sorry, I'm looking down. I'm trying to read the questions while I talk here. So just briefly, I'll kind of read through these and then maybe we can just riff on them a little. So we talked about turnouts, long-term impact to national politics. That's a great question. We'll get to vote by mail, which we can hit on a little more, and then Biden and who he might pick as a VP. So just maybe I'll take those in reverse order and then Lance can hop on in. As far as Biden, you know, I doubt that his choice will be affected by this. I think the timing of his choice might be, but I think he has a short list. I think he is going through that. He hasn't really hidden really even who's on his short list. He said he will have a female vice presidential candidate. So I'd be shocked if he broke that promise. You know, Kamala Harris clearly at the top of that list, it would seem, as well as some others. So I don't think this makes it more likely that we'll have a more progressive candidate. Biden has definitely not been quite as active, I think, lately. But it makes sense. It's hard to campaign. Campaigning is at its core is about human contact, sometimes even physical contact, right? It's hard to run a campaign. I think candidates are still figuring that out. Vote by mail. That's one thing. If you don't pay a lot of attention to politics and you're watching this, I would be watching that a lot. So there's been a kind of a larger conversation about voting rights versus voting security. And that's an oversimplification, but I think for today, for the internet, we can get away with that maybe. And I think this vote by mail conversation has, again, it's kind of highlighted that fissure. So we've got in North Carolina, a lot of top Republicans saying, hey, vote by mail is a real security risk. And then you've got a lot of Democrats saying, you know what, right now, the key is to get as many people to vote as possible. And vote by mail, given everything Lance pointed out before, is a good way to do that. So the State Board of Elections has given some suggestions to the General Assembly. I think folks should watch to see how much they follow those. Another one to pay attention to that may not be getting the headlines, but the average poll worker, so the person who runs the polls in America, is elderly, is over 60 years of age. And so this is the exact same group that is at the greatest risk with COVID-19. And so one of the proposals that's getting less attention, but I would argue is very important and perhaps can be bipartisan, is increasing efforts to get younger poll workers. And I think that seems like an administrative detail, but it's a really important one. We know that when people see poll workers who look like them, they have more faith in the process. And I think it's from a public health perspective, that is important as well. I think that what this means nationally going forward is going to be interesting to watch, right? I mean, I think on the one hand, there's some positives. Again, this big stimulus bill, whatever you think of it, was a bipartisan compromise. And so I think we've been saying we want more bipartisan compromise. This is what it looks like. I think this is, again, though, highlighting what some of these bigger fissures that I don't necessarily see going away. So, Lance, I'm sure you have smart things to add to that.
Yeah. So as far as going back down to like Biden's VP pick, I'm not sure like COVID itself really will be a deciding factor in that. It might be more like geographic nuanced choice. Like I know like the governor of Michigan, who has gotten national attention due to COVID, she's on that short list. And Michigan's very important, the Electoral College. I mean, I think the president only won it by less than a percentage point in 2016. So tight, tight state. I know Stacey Abrams, the former gubernatorial candidate in Georgia. Georgia is moving to kind of becoming a purple state, just demographic shifts in the state. And also Biden's nomination, in large part, South Carolina primaries, African-American women that really put him over the top. So kind of paying homage to a very serious voting block for him. That might be an option, same with Kamala Harris. I definitely think he keeps the female running mate pledge. But I think, his short list will be more kind of electorally advantageous, which oftentimes VP picks tend to be, or they balance some aspect of the ticket. You know, so in this case, he's probably going to pick somebody more youthful due to him being in his 70s. And, you know, that's kind of how he got selected in 08, was Obama was youthful and, you know, he kind of chose an elder statesman running mate. So let's see. So the second question was going in reverse order. Let's see here. The vote by mail. That's interesting. Like the partisan divide on that for sure is something that to be watching play out. my comparison state in these COVID papers, Colorado, they vote heavily by mail. So that's, it's kind of an existing infrastructure in some states. So I think some of those states are pretty much primed and ready to go. But obviously, you know, North Carolina, you know, we're early voting and voting, you know, election day and absentee. So it'll be interesting to see what our state does going forward with that. I think a lot of it really depends on how long this current outbreak ends. If it seems like it's dying off by the fall, and that even if there is a second resurgence, that we're more prepared, able to isolate it, that kind of thing, vaccine on the horizon, it may just, it may not be as a forefront of an issue as it is like now in the middle of the, you know, shutdown and all of this. So I think it really depends on the duration of this.
Yeah, I think you're exactly right.
For sure. And then nationally, how this plays out, yeah, I agree as far as the bipartisanship. It's true. Everybody's like, oh, I just want, you know, Washington to work. I want bills to go through. I want people to just get along, less partisan infighting. And the stimulus is good proof of that. So it is interesting to see that play out. And kind of as I was saying before, I think collectively as a country, I think this will, there'll be lasting impacts from this for sure. Obviously, more than likely, there's going to be some fairly long-term economic ramifications from this. You know, that's why they're passing stimulus bills. But also I think just people being hesitant to be in large crowds, you know, things like concerts and stuff, people might have second thoughts even once things are starting to go back to normal about kind of attending those for a while, even handshakes. You know, it'd be interesting to see if that's kind of what we do when we greet somebody in the near term. So,
yeah. No, I think you're right. I think a lot of us are having a question, a lot of these kind of social norms that we have. It's mm-hmm. hard to go out act. So maybe we'll wrap up. I mean, and you know, just I'll say, actually, Lance, what, maybe do you have anything to say and wrap up, and then I'll do one more, and then we'll kind of close out.
Oh, sure. Yeah, this has been a really cool experience. Thank you, Dr. Cooper, for having me on here. And yeah, I think it's main thing is it's just really going to be interesting to see how this all plays out. And a lot of it is unknown. It really hinges on how long, you know, this kind of national pandemic lockdown kind of stays, like how long we stay in our current mode. And I think that will really be determinative of what comes this fall with the election and everything else.
No, I think you're exactly right. And I think, you know, kind of in closing on my end, I mean, you know, obviously everybody's health needs to be the number one concern. So I hope that's the thing we're paying attention to.
Yeah.
Is a secondary issue. I do hope that folks are paying attention to government. I mean, this is kind of a master class in how government responds. And I think it really highlights, yes, the federal government's incredibly important. We're all going to get checks that will show some of the very real ways in which the federal government is important. At the same time, I think this is really highlighting the power of state and local governments to make decisions that really and truly affect our lives. So I think as we think through how to respond to government moving forward, just paying attention to state and local issues, because I think that's where the rubber meets the road on so many of these issues. Let's see here. Yeah, I think we should probably close out, although we got a great question from one of my favorite ex-students, Preston Blake. All right, I'll grab it real quick, and then we'll really close out. So Preston, who is somebody's political career I would watch if you're paying attention to Western North Carolina politics, is asking about the overrepresentation of African Americans in COVID-19 cases and deaths. And then he said some nice words about me, so he must be feeling very strange. But as far as the racial piece, yeah, I think that's critical. Again, this, I mean, I'm not a biologist, obviously, or a medical doctor, don't pretend to be one. The medical end is one thing, but I think socially, again, this highlights some structural inequalities that we have in America and access to healthcare. And we talked about that in the urban-rural divide before, but I think as far as race, mm-hmm. yes, I think this matters in some real ways that are incredibly important that we we probably didn't talk about enough. So I'm glad Preston brought that up.
No, absolutely.
And so, yeah, I think, you know, it's not equally easy for everybody to work from home, to take time off, to find health care, to find child care. And a pandemic like this doesn't alleviate structural inequality. It highlights them. And I think it's critical that we pay attention to that as well.
Absolutely.
So we'll with that, I think maybe we'll let it go. But thank everybody for tuning in. And thanks to Lance for being here and offering such great insight. So hope everybody has a good day.
Yeah, thanks, everybody.